God. Praise God. Let the people of God say amen. Amen. I welcome you to the Bread Broadcast, a Bible teaching program where we edify, we exhort, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call sinners to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today, we are going to be talking about your visa to Beyond the Blue. Your visa to Beyond the Blue. My visa to, see. And our case study is going to be the rich young ruler. That's his name in the Bible. He didn't have a proper name. And our short reading is going to be the gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 19, verse 16 to 30. Matthew 19, 16 to 30. Let us pray. Oh, dear Father God, thank you. Lord Jesus, sweet Redeemer, hallowed be your holy name. Sweet blessed Holy Spirit, we honor you. Father, we pray that through our Lord Jesus Christ, by your Spirit, you will open up our understanding to this topic, that we'll come away from this lesson knowing and understanding what you are asking of us concerning our faith walk. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Our foundation text is Revelation chapter 18, verse 4, Revelation 18, 4. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, come out of her, my people, lest you share in her sins, and lest you receive of her plagues. What is the visa beyond the blue? My family, by the grace of God, we've moved a few times, traveling from country to country. Sometimes we changed continents. So I know a little bit about visa. This is something that you need to enter a country other than your own country. If you don't, then you are a lawbreaker. If you don't get a visa to go into a country and you come in, or you lie to come into that country, you are a lawbreaker and you will be treated like a lawbreaker, you see. But if you want to come in into a country as a law-abiding individual who will be respected, you will go to their embassy and you will apply for their visa. And if your case is genuine, if your case is legit, they'll give you your visa, you see. So what is our visa beyond the blue, that is to heaven? It starts with salvation. Salvation. And it grows into setting apart, which theologically is called holiness, you know, in the Bible. See? So our visa to heaven starts with salvation. We are going to be doing things a little bit differently in this lesson, but the Lord will help us. Now, what is the source of the visa? The source is, it has to be Calvary procured. The rich young ruler came to the Lord Jesus to ask how he might have eternal life. This young ruler took the first step in the right direction, you see, by coming to the Lord. However, his motive was wrong, for he thought there was something he could do to earn eternal life. Listen up. There is nothing good enough that you and I can do that can erase our sins from God's book? Nothing. The Bible says all our righteousness is like filthy rags, you see. So nothing we can do. That's why the Lord Jesus had to die, you see. He had to die. Now, whoever wants their sin wiped off from God's book must come to God's embassy, you see. Like, if you want to come to America, from your country, you go to the American embassy in your country. That's where you interface with their immigration and you take the process from there. So if you want to go to heaven, you go to God's embassy. Where is that? It's called Calvary. Calvary is the place where Jesus died. But for us, in today's language, is now representative of the death of Jesus. There, you will need to surrender all your credentials, all your paperwork of sin. Getting this? You recognize that you need a savior. Like you will apply that I would like to travel to America, I need a visa. So you will say, I need a savior, you see. Confess the Lord Jesus as the Son of God and receive him as your personal Lord. Just like the woman caught in adultery, when Jesus told accusers, he said, if any one of you is without sin, cast the first stone. Of course, none of them could cast the stone because they knew they were sinners too. They left. And Jesus said, woman, where are your accusers? And she said, and the Lord said, did no one condemn you? She said, Lord, none. You see, she called Jesus Lord. At that point, she had put her faith in Jesus by calling him Lord. The Bible says nobody calls Jesus Lord except by the Spirit of God, you see. So she said, Lord, nobody condemned me. And Jesus said, I don't condemn you too. So go, sin no more, you see. She received forgiveness. That story is in John chapter 8, verse 1 to 11. The thief on the cross, he called out to Jesus. He said, Lord, again, he said, Lord, remember me when you get to your kingdom. And the Lord Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. How did he get saved? He called Jesus Lord. He received him personally, you see. He didn't have time to go do baptism because he was on the cross as a thief. But he had put his faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. That story again is in Luke 23:39-43. The only way to receive heaven's authentic visa is by faith in Christ Jesus alone. Not in Muhammad, not in Buddha, no. Confucius will lead you to hell. Atheism will lead you to hell. You see, only Jesus can take you to heaven. Let's go to Acts chapter 10, verse 43. Acts 10, 43. To him all the prophets witness that through his name, through whose name? The Lord Jesus' name. Whoever believes in him will receive remission of sins. If you believe in the Lord Jesus, it means your sins will be wiped off. Acts 4:12. Nor is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved, you see. You either agree with God or you don't, you see. But you cannot come to heaven on your own terms. No. I was talking to a lady. She believed in the Lord Jesus, and she said, I will come to heaven on my own terms. I smiled. I'm like, man, You can't. There's only one way. You see, if you say you want to go to heaven on your own terms, you're talking the lake of fire. That's where you go. Because God has only given one way, and is Jesus Christ the Lord. To put your faith in the Lord Jesus is to receive one free admission ticket to heaven. To put your faith in the Lord Jesus is to receive one free admission ticket to heaven. Moving on. The nature of the visa is characteristically professional. The rich young ruler came to the Lord Jesus with a fake holiness. Listen now, church people. You go to church, but you are not even sure that your sins are blotted out of God's book. Listen up, if you're a pagan Christian. The rich young ruler boasted in keeping the law. However, the Bible tells us that to break one of the laws is to break the rest of the laws, you see. He boasted to Jesus that, oh, I've kept all the laws. By the time Jesus finished with him, we realized that he had not even kept the first and the great commandment. The first and the great commandment says, thou shalt love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your strength, and all your mind. Ten Commandments, it says, thou shalt not have another God before me. But he couldn't leave his wealth for Jesus. So he already broke the first law, you see. And he was there boasting to Jesus, oh, I've kept all the laws, you see. The type of holiness recognized in heaven is not one of keeping rules. Listen up, track with me, please. But of divine ability, which comes directly from the indwelling of the Holy Spirit inside a believer. The Bible is not the book of do's and don'ts. If you live your life like that, if you are living like that, you are yet to receive the authentic visa of heaven. If your life, your Christian life, is about do's and don'ts, no. That's not what Christianity is about. No. When you receive the Lord Jesus into your life, the power of the Holy Spirit, the person of the Holy Spirit, will come inside of you. And through him, it will be easy for you to live a separated life unto Jesus. The Holy Spirit inside a believer helps a believer to live godly in ungodly environments. All those who live their Christian life as a life of do's and don'ts, eventually they fall out. They get tired. They get weary. Like, oh my goodness, I don't smoke, I don't cuss, I don't do fornication, they are counting it. By the time they do that for like 6 years, they will get tired and they fall out, you see. Just as the rich young ruler fell out when he came face to face with divine truth. The characteristic professional mark of the Holy Spirit in the life of a set apart Christian is the supernatural godly remorse which triggers 180 degrees turn to a new life. That is how you know if the visa that you are carrying to heaven is authentic. The Holy Spirit will come inside of you and will empower you supernaturally to make 180 degrees. So if you have been living as a thief, a fornicator, a gossip before, the power of the Holy Spirit will turn you the other way. And you start to live right. You see. This was greatly exemplified in the life of Saul of Tarsus, who was a religious terrorist. And later, he became the Apostle Paul, who actually was martyred for the gospel, you see. The Holy Spirit came into his life and he turned from being a religious terrorist this way and became a missionary. What happened? That was the characteristic mark, professional mark of the Holy Spirit working in his life, working in my life, working in the lives of many people. Let's go to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verse 26. The book of prophet Ezekiel 36, 26. This is God speaking. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit within you. That's talking about the Holy Spirit. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh, that is cold, hardened heart. God said, I'll take it out and I will give you a heart of flesh. He's saying, I will give you a tender heart toward me, towards the word of God. You see, that is the characteristic professional mark of the Holy Spirit. An invisible fight requires an invisible fight. If you have been saying, oh, this Christian life is too difficult, I'm counting all the rules every day, and it's too hard. It's because you are yet to receive the power of the Holy Spirit. You cannot live the spiritual life with a physical strength. An invisible fight requires an invisible might. Moving on. Use of the visa. How do you use this visa? Consistently practiced. That is how you use it. The Lord Jesus told the rich young ruler to go sell all he had, give the money to the poor, and then follow him as a disciple. The rich young ruler could not follow the Lord. Why? Because he could not see himself being separated from the wealth which was his identity and fulfillment in life. You see, unlike Zacchaeus, that's a very good example. When Zacchaeus became converted and he gave his life to the Lord Jesus and he put his faith in Christ Jesus, he said, Lord, if I cheated anyone or by false accusations I've taken from anyone wrongly, I am going to give them back fourfold whatever I've taken from them. The Lord Jesus didn't ask Zacchaeus to do that. No. He himself began to practice his new faith, you see. That story of Zacchaeus is in Luke 19:8. A life that possesses the original visa to heaven, please listen, is a life that follows the Lord Jesus at all times in all situations. The identity and fulfillment of such believers are in Christ Jesus. Self-ambition is dead because they now live according to the Lord's values, you see. A professing Christian who consistently craves the same life values as unbelievers is not carrying heaven's legitimate visa. No, you are not. You call yourself a born-again, twice-born Christian, and all your life values are in sync with your neighbor who is a pagan, or your cousin who is a pagan. Something is wrong with you. Something is wrong with your Christianity. You know why? If indeed you are carrying authentic heaven's visa, holiness, you will be set apart. Your values will be different from theirs. If they laugh at sitcoms that glorifies adultery, you will find it repugnant. Because the Holy Spirit in you will let you know you can't be smiling and laughing at adultery on TV. No. It's a sin. If they are breaking the law on the street by causing chaos, you will not line up your values with theirs, because the Bible says you ought to respect obey all authorities. You see. Now, I'm not saying, let me make a disclaimer. I am not saying something like, maybe you are cheering for your football team and your pagan neighbor is also cheering for the same team. That's not what we are talking about. No. It's nothing like, oh, we like the same football team. No. We are talking life values on marriage. Is Jesus the only way to heaven? On life at conception. We are talking real life stuff. If your values concerning those areas, if they line up with your pagan friends or your pagan neighbor, you don't have the authentic visa in your hand. No. Because if you do, you will follow the biblical views that we have from the Word of God. And those are in sharp contrast to that the people of the world, they hold dear to themselves. Oh, we are so different. Let's go to Luke 14:33. Luke 14:33. So likewise, this is Jesus speaking. Whoever of you does not forsake all that he has, that is, make them secondary, cannot be my disciple. You see, when you become a disciple of the Lord, when you have that authentic visa in your hand, that you are going to heaven because you have really put your faith in Christ Jesus, listen, your life values will change. So things that are so important to people of the world will be meaningless to you, you see. And that is where the differentiation comes in. To feed on heavenly nutrition is to flee from fleshly pollution. Let me say that again. To feed on heavenly nutrition is to flee from fleshly pollution. Moving on. What is the reputation of the visa? Some countries, if you get their visa, people will tell you, don't even bother about it, because their visa is worthless. But some countries in the world, when you get their visa, it's like, oh my, how did you get that? Because the visa is very, very valuable, you see, on where you can travel to in the world. So what is the reputation of heaven's visa? It's conspicuously positioned. That is the reputation. The rich young ruler was known by his wealth and was thus addressed in the Bible. He was not known for his faith in the God of Abraham, whose laws he boasted of keeping. Just as many Jewish leaders believed Jesus, but didn't openly commit to Jesus, because they loved the praise of men than the praise of God. That's in Acts 12:42-43. A believer who is carrying a genuine heaven's visa, if indeed you have been saved and you have been set apart living in holiness, you will be known by everybody for your unapologetic biblical views. Oh yeah. Such a believer holds biblical views as the foundation and the final authority of their opinions on every matter. A believer, listen up, who double speak, if you call yourself a believer, a Christian, but you double speak, or you dumb down, or deny biblical views for fame or for gain, you are not carrying heaven-recognized holiness, no matter who you are. I like to say it. It doesn't matter which tag you like to go by. Pastor, prophet, bishop, chief pastor, pope, it doesn't matter. If you double speak, you deny or you dumb down biblical views, You are not carrying the same heaven's visa which the likes of Apostle Paul and Apostle Peter that they carried and they died for. Oh no. When people ask for your opinion, I don't have opinion on abortion. Oh no. I don't have opinion on homosexuality. I don't. Who cares about my opinion? If you ask for my opinion, I don't have one. My opinion is what the Bible says. Whatever the Bible says is my opinion. Because this is where my authority, this is where my life is in the Word of God. You see. And it's the same for every Bible-believing Christian. Let's go to the Gospel according to St. Matthew, chapter 10, verse 32. We stop at 33. Matthew 10, 32 to 33. Therefore, whoever confesses me before men, him I will also confess before my Father who is in heaven. This is our Lord Jesus speaking. But whoever denies me before men, him I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Did you hear that? I didn't write that. You see, to fail to speak up for the Lord is to fail to stand up for the Lord. To fail to speak up for the Lord is to fail to stand up for the Lord. So, what have we done so far? What is our visa to beyond the blue? Our visa to beyond the blue is living a separated life to the Lord, different from the world. It starts with salvation and continues in holiness. What is the source of the visa? It's Calvary procured. It can only come from the Lord Jesus. What is the nature of the visa? It's characteristically professional. It is only lived through the power of the Holy Spirit. What is the use of the visa? Is consistently practiced. It makes our values different from the values of unbelievers at all times. What is the reputation of this visa? This visa that we are talking about is conspicuously positioned. Others know us to live by biblical values in every matter of life. Now, as a believer, how are you known? What are you known for? What are you known for? If you are not known for your unbending biblical values, if you are not known for your unbending biblical values, your Christianity is very questionable. Oh, yeah. According to the word of the Lord, your Christianity is questionable. The Lord Jesus is saying, come out of the world, come out of its lifestyles and values, lest you share in the world's sins, lest you receive of the world's plagues. I love the way Dr. Rogers put it, if you conform to the world, you will be condemned with the world. A great loss await every self-professing Christian who fails to live a separated life. Now, if you're an unbeliever, listen up. Come close. Are you watching? You're a pagan. You don't believe in Jesus. You're a mud dweller. Say what? The Bible says so. That you're living in flood of dissipation. You see. That's in 1 Peter 4:4. If you want to check it out. So you are living in the mud of sin. But that can change. Heaven is a perfect place. Only those who have been washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus can enter in. Unless you put your faith in the Lord Jesus and receive him into your heart for him to become your Lord, as that prostitute called Lord, as that thief called Lord, and they made him personal Unless you do that, you cannot go to heaven. Oh no. You are headed, listen up, for an eternal disaster, where you will be in torment as if you are going to die, burning, in pain, thirsty. You'll be feeling like you are going to die, but the problem is you don't die forever and ever and ever. 6 billion years, you are just starting forever, you see. However, you don't have to end up there. That's why Jesus died for you. Because he loved you. A link is coming up. If you want to know how to escape that evil, eternal evil of lake of fire that awaits everyone who fails to receive Jesus, if you want to know how to escape, follow that link. We'll meet you there. Father God, thank you for empowering me, dear sweet blessed Holy Spirit, to deliver the words of our Lord Jesus. Father, I have delivered the message you gave me. I commit these people into your hands. Oh Lord, burn this word into their hearts in the name of Jesus. And as many that we hear it and want to commit their lives into your hands, Father, open up their understanding so that they will do it with all of their hearts and not just do it as if out of duty, but they will know it's a matter of life and death. Thank you, dear sweet Jesus. For in Jesus' name have we prayed. Amen and amen. I will see you next week, only if Jesus has not split the sky open.